The Bible is full of stories of people who walked with God, who lived their lives for Jesus. I thought of people like Abraham and Sarah, David and Esther and Daniel, Mary Magdalene and Peter and Paul. And some had great moments. They followed God, even at a risk and not knowing where they were going. They lived lives of greatness and experienced victory and triumph. They proclaimed their total devotion, their total commitment and trust in Jesus, and they were even willing to die for him. But they also had times of deep regret. They didn't trust God's promises. They sinned. They made big mistakes. They had times of difficulty and sorrow and heartbreak. There were moments of fear and betrayal and doubt. And you've heard me say this, I've already said it once today. I am so thankful, so very thankful for the scriptures and for the stories of ordinary men and women who are just like us, who faced struggles and hardship as well as the joy and victory as they walked with God. They weren't perfect. They're like us. And as we've been looking through the book of Acts, we've seen this pattern of faithfulness and struggle, this back and forth. The disciples were committed to following Jesus, and yet they stumbled, and some even failed, as they grew and learned what it meant to live their lives for Jesus in their everyday lives, and also to be the church and to share the good news with others. Last week, we looked at the story of Peter and Cornelius, and Peter's aha moment when God shows him this vision of the breadth of his plan, his great plan of salvation, that God is bringing all people together, Jews and Gentiles, into one big family in Christ Jesus. Peter had expected, as the Jews did at that day, that Gentiles would convert to Judaism to become a Christian, and that they would follow the laws, the Jewish laws. And his understanding is transformed as he grasps that God has granted the Gentiles repentance into eternal life and through faith in Jesus Christ and in the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And it's a huge paradigm shift for the Jews and for the early church. And the shift is not easy for them. Read the book of Galatians, and you read Peter's letters, you see this shift is not easy for them. It creates lots of struggle and lots of strife and difficulty. And Carrie read verses from the end, towards the end of Acts chapter 11. And we read that the church is being persecuted and they scatter from Jerusalem. They continue to share the good news, but mostly with Jews. But there's some that travel as far as Antioch and they share with Greeks. And it says that great numbers of people believe and turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. And the church in Jerusalem sends Barnabas to Antioch to encourage and teach the people. And that Antioch church will soon become the hub, the central hub for ministry to the Gentiles. While all of this is going on, and this spans a period of numbers of years, since his conversion, Paul has had a supernatural revelations, numbers of revelations from Jesus, and it reorients his faith to understand who Jesus really is and what Jesus came to do, and to reveal the message that he will start to preach. And over the next 14 years, Paul preaches the gospel to the Gentiles. Through that period of time, he's welcomed by Peter and James and John, the pillars of the church in Jerusalem, and he's accepted as an apostle to the Gentiles. And now, at this point in the story, in chapter 11, Barnabas goes to Tarsus and brings Paul back to Antioch. And together, the two of them proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, and they teach the new believers. And the disciples, it says the disciples are first called Christians in Antioch. Meanwhile, back in Jerusalem, King Herod is continuing to persecute the Christians that are still left there. And he puts some of them in prison, and the Apostle John, the first one that is recorded of the 12, is put to death. And it says that this pleases the Jews. I think what hard words to hear. This pleases the Jews, and so he arrests Peter too. And the church is alarmed, and they gather to pray for his release. And the night before he's brought to trial, as Peter is sleeping between guards, chained to guards, an angel of the Lord comes into his cell, and the chains fall from his hands, and the locked doors are opened, and the angel guides him past soldiers, armed soldiers, who are now sleeping at their posts. And he leads Peter to freedom. And Peter thinks it's a vision, that it's a dream. He doesn't even realize what's happening until all of a sudden the angel leaves him and he kind of comes to his senses and realizes what's happened. And he goes to Mary's house where he knows there's a large crowd of people that are gathered and are praying for him. And he knocks on the door. And again, I did this story. You know the story. They don't believe that it's Peter. And then when they finally see him, they can't believe that their prayers have been answered. And Peter tells them everything that's happened, and he encourages them, and then he leaves for Jerusalem. He leaves Jerusalem for another place, it says, and I expect he is going somewhere safer. And the understanding is that at this time, he went to Antioch, where Paul and Barnabas are. And there's an interesting story in Galatians chapter 2 of something that happens in Antioch. And I share this story again because when we think of what does it mean to be Holy Spirit-filled followers of Jesus Christ, we can sometimes put these Bible characters into a real big, like they're on these big pillars up there, that they're beyond us. And so I share a story like this to show you, no, they're not. They're people like you and me. They make mistakes. Sometimes they make big mistakes. Sometimes they really, really can be drawn away from what is the truth. So Peter gets to Antioch. He has good fellowship with the Gentile and Jewish Christians there. They eat together. They worship God together. They share communion together. They are in unity and they are in fellowship together. This is normal for Peter. He had his vision from God. God opened his eyes. He knows that this is what it's supposed to be like, and it's wonderful. But then a group of influential Jews arrive in Antioch from Jerusalem. They're claiming to be representatives of James, the leader of the church in Jerusalem. These new visitors come in, and they eat by themselves. They set themselves apart. They're aloof. They follow the Jewish laws, and it's taboo for Jews to eat with Gentiles. And they're called the circumcision group. They're legalists. And it can be hard for us to kind of understand what's happening, how this can be. I want to give you an example, and this is nowhere close to the seriousness of what is happening there, but just to give you an idea of something, how we can do some of these same things today. My cousins and I got into a conversation about baptism a number of years ago. And they were insistent that you weren't baptized unless you were immersed. That's the way John the Baptist did it. That's the way it had to be. We talked back and forth about it. And then I very simply shared my baptism story with them. I was baptized by my dad as he poured water over my head as I kneeled at the front of the church. They were shocked. They loved my dad. He was their uncle. They looked up to him, and they knew me, and they knew my faith in Jesus, and they didn't know what to say. I picture this circumcision group looking on with disapproval at the freedom and the joy in the Lord that these Christ followers are having and experiencing. They look down on them as they're eating together. They know the truth. And the rest of the church continues to eat together for a while. But soon Peter feels the pressure. And he pulls back and it says he separates himself from the Gentiles because he's afraid of those who belong to the circumcision group. And soon the other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas is led astray. And just again, for clarification, the circumcision group believes that you have to follow the Jewish law to become a Christian. Gentiles have to convert to Judaism. They have to follow the law. Peter knows that this is something that God has already showed him very clearly that wasn't necessary. And second, Peter's a hypocrite. Paul calls him a hypocrite by doing what he does. He's a phony. He's afraid of what the Jews will say. So he bows to peer pressure and he doesn't practice what he believes. He sins. And he does, as he does, the other Jewish Christians follow his example, even Barnabas. And now you have a church where you have the Jews on one side together, and you have the Gentiles on another side together. When they have communion, which is often shared at a common meal, you have the Jews having communion together, and the Gentiles separate, having communion together. The two groups are divided, and there's division in their worship. And they're not in fellowship and unity together. And Paul is the only one who doesn't join in the hypocrisy, and Paul is very disturbed. And Paul publicly and personally confronts Peter's sin. Paul calls Peter a hypocrite. His actions are practically a denial of the truth of the gospel. He's changing the gospel to a gospel of works, not faith. And Paul says to Peter, "You've been living like a Gentile, making no distinction between Jews and non-Jews. How could you now insist, as your behavior is insisting, on Gentiles becoming Jews in order to become part of God's family? We who are Jews by birth know that we are not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we have put our faith in Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law." Peter is betraying the very heart of the gospel by adding obedience to the law as a condition of salvation. Peter knows that. He knows that God's making one family out of the two, bringing Jews and Gentiles together. He knows that salvation is for both the Jews and the Gentiles through faith in Jesus Christ and the infilling of the Holy Spirit. He experienced it when he was with Cornelius. He knows that. He hasn't changed his thinking. He's changed his behavior. And he's reacting to peer pressure. He doesn't want the Jews from Jerusalem to look down on him. He doesn't want them to condemn his actions. And so he's a hypocrite. And he pretends to be something he isn't. And he leads others into sin by his actions. And Paul stands up and challenges him and confronts him with the error of his ways. There's three things I want to highlight from this encounter. There's actually more, but I had to cut it down a little bit. But these are three things that really stuck out to me. What does it look like to be a Holy Spirit-filled follower of Jesus? You look at Peter, and you see someone who stumbled, and someone who fails. But as you continue to read, you'll also see someone who gets back up again. And I thought, we also stumble. We fail. We aren't perfect either. And I love Psalms 37:23. It says, "The Lord delights in the way of the person whose steps he has made firm. Though they stumble, they will not fall, for the Lord holds them with his hand." Isn't that wonderful? God delights in us. Psalms 37, verse 23. I love when I'm reading the Psalms and come after that verse is highlighted in my Bible. Though they stumble, and though they stumble, they will not fall. I think there's a difference between failing and falling. The Lord upholds them in his hand. And I just think God delights in us. He holds us in his hand. He keeps us from falling. And I just want to encourage us that the early church were people like you and I. They weren't perfect and we aren't either. But we are learning and we are growing into faithful followers of Jesus Christ. And it's often through tests and trials as we stumble heavenward. The second is peer pressure. Peer pressure can be so strong. It can be very tempting for young people, but it can be tempting for older people as well. We want to be accepted. We want to be liked. We want to have fun. We know people who call themselves Christians and yet live the way they please. They may portray themselves one way in church and another way when they're with their friends. And sometimes even in Christian circles, it can seem like anything goes. There are many forms of spirituality out there. You kind of pick and choose what works for you. And then there are those who look down on others who are doing as they desire. And it's so tempting to join the crowd. It's so tempting to take the easier route instead of holding on to faith and what we know is right. And knowing that there is often struggle involved. It is not easy living a life for the Lord. There are struggles, there are difficulties. But the Lord holds us in his hand, we remember that. So I encourage, especially you young ones, but all of us, be encouraged by the people of faith as you read the scriptures. Read the stories of Abraham And you see a man who was faithful in following God, and yet he didn't get it all right. I encourage you to find a few good friends who really love the Lord and want to walk with Jesus like you do. But not only just your age, but older ones as well. Older ones who know you and who love you and who desire to see you following and walking with Jesus. People who will pray for you and will encourage you to stay strong in the faith. Peter writes in his letter, "Grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." You want to have those kinds of people that you know really care for you. You want to have those kinds of people around you. Those are also people then that you can come to when you are struggling and when you are needing someone to talk to, someone to pray with you. And third, we are accountable to each other. Paul was pretty hard on Peter. I just kind of told the story, but when you read it, he was really hard on Peter. Made me wonder, how did Peter feel? How did he react to that public rebuke? And it was public because Peter was a leader in the church. It's not that it always is that way, but he led others into following him. Do you think Peter hated Paul after that? We're not told. But in his second letter, Peter references his dear brother Paul. And in a few weeks, we're going to be coming to Acts 15. And we'll see Peter and Paul and Barnabas standing together in defense of the faith against strong opposition. They're together. So Peter might not have liked it right away, but he was willing to accept it and to learn from it and to grow. As part of the body of Christ, we're accountable to each other. We're expected to help each other to live faithfully for the Lord. And there are times that it may include confrontation, talking to someone, but given in genuine love and care and concern. And it may not feel good, and we may feel like lashing out and defending ourselves. But I am so thankful for all of you, people that I love dearly and people that I know love me. And I know, because I've had people speak to me already, that I know that you will also confront me if you see sin and something that isn't right in my life. And I hope we are all open to receiving from each other and growing up together into all that Christ has for us. We continue to learn and to grow and to be the church together. And what a beautiful picture it is when we are united in fellowship together, functioning as the body of Christ with Jesus as our head. And we're told in Scripture that our love for each other is a witness to the watching world. May we represent Christ well. Let's pray together. Thank you, O God. Thank you for your word. Thank you that Paul included this story. The story that doesn't really put Peter in good light. But yet when we read this story, we can identify with it. And we can see then afterwards how Peter is restored again, and how he stands tall in the faith, and his letters that are written to Gentiles as he proclaims the gospel to them and as he encourages them to stand firm in the faith. Lord, I pray that we also may continue, that our desire, our focus may be to continue to grow and in you, to walk with you. And Lord, when we do stumble, and when we do fail, that we may turn to you, that we may turn to people around us that we know and love us, that will walk with us through whatever that situation may be. Lord, may we find deep friendships with people our own age, as people older, younger, ones that we can really fellowship with, that can walk with us and encourage us to continue to walk with Jesus. Lord, I thank you for the very youngest ones to the oldest of us. We are part of your family. Help us to represent you well, O God. And even to represent you when we acknowledge our sin and when we confess. And thank you that you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, I just pray again that your Spirit will stir what you desire to stir in each of us, that we may be encouraged in our faith in you. As we go out this week again, I just pray that we may have opportunities to share the good news of Jesus Christ in our words and in our actions. And Lord, as you have blessed us, may we be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen.